It's good to be here today. It's good to see that we have a full panel. As General Sullivan stated, this was the day that America entered the Great War, as it was then called. And during World War I, the Army grew from a constabulary force of about 100,000 professionals to a conscript army of 4 million. The Navy changed in an equally rapid fashion from a small force built around a few powerful battleships to one consisting of hundreds of smaller craft for combating submarines. The American military effort was immense, in some cases unique, supporting a 2 million man expeditionary force 3,000 miles from home, fighting a war with allies for the first time since 1783, and attempting to mobilize the entire industrial economy to prosecute the war. So it really was, in many respects, it certainly was our first 20th century war and arguably our first industrial war. We have four real experts, three real experts. I'm the fourth one up here. I was a history major. We have three real experts today on the American participation in World War I, and it's my pleasure to introduce them. Michael Neiberg was the inaugural chair of war studies in the Department of National Security and Strategy at the Army War College. His published work specializes on the First and Second World Wars, notably on the American and French experiences. His most recent book on the First World War is Dance of the Furies. What a great title. Europe and the Outbreak of War of World War I. The Wall Street Journal recently named it one of the five best books ever written about that war. In October, Oxford University Press published his Path to War, a history of the American responses to the Great War. He'll talk to us today about the state of the U.S. Army in April 1917. Edward Lengel is the chief historian at the White House Historical Association. Before beginning work there, he was in the fall of 2016, he directed the Washington papers, the published papers of George Washington for a number of years. He was a military historian, the author of several books, including General George Washington, A Military Life, To Conquer Hell, The Meuse-Argonne, 1918, and the Army Historical Foundation award-winning Thunder and Flames, Americans in the Crucible of Combat, 1917 to 1918. Dr. Lengel will speak to us today about the development of the U.S. Army after the Declaration of War. Finally, John Maurer is the Alfred Thayer Mahan Professor of Sea Power and Strategy at the Naval War College. He's the author and editor of books examining the outbreak of World War I, military interventions in the developing world, naval rivalries, and arms control between the world wars, and a study about Winston Churchill's views on foreign policy and grand strategy. Today, appropriately, he will talk about America's strategy for winning the war. The speakers will speak in the order that I just announced their names. Mike Neiberg.
Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you for this opportunity to be here and to talk to you on this very important anniversary. The First World War is, as I'm sure you all know, a critical event to American history. It's a critical event in European history. It's a critical event in world history. Yet it's also an event that we really haven't studied a lot. The study of the First World War, the histories of the First World War, are filled with a lot of half-truths and a lot of emptiness in our understanding. Now, centennials, if they're going to be about anything, should be an occasion to look at an event anew and to ask new questions. Go back to what we thought we knew. Go back to the original sources. Now, textbooks will tell you a couple of things about the First World War. My daughter, my 11th grade daughter, brought home her history textbook, showed it to me. I was almost appalled enough to go and talk to the teacher, but then I realized it wasn't the teacher's fault. Two things that jumped out at me. The first is the argument in this book, as in many textbooks, that the reason the United States was not prepared for war in 1917, allegedly, was because the United States had been completely isolationist and not paying attention to the war. This is one myth that just does not stand up to historical analysis. The second is that the sinking of the Lusitania, the event depicted on this first slide that I have here, brought the United States into the First World War. Now, my daughter brought home this quiz, this worksheet she was supposed to fill out, and said, "Daddy, which of these led America into World War I?" And the answer she was supposed to give was the sinking of the Lusitania. My answer to her was, "None of these is right, but circle C because that's what your teacher wants." Now, the Lusitania, of course, happened in May of 1915. American entry waits, it's 2 years before that happens. And a very famous event in among at least American historians that have studied this, the New York newspaper syndicates did a survey of 1,000 American newspapers in 1915 and found just 6 in favor of war over the Lusitania. So quite obviously, the causal link is weak, to say the least. But the Lusitania is a critical, critical, critical event for reasons that I hope to explain here. What I want to do in about the 20 minutes or 25 minutes that I have is explain to you exactly why, the best I can in 20, 25 minutes, why the United States Army was in the condition that it was in 1917. And as I hope to show you, it had nothing to do with isolation. The real story of why the American Army found itself in the position it found itself in exactly one century today will sound much more familiar, and I think will explain much more, not only about the events of 100 years ago, but will help us understand the relevance to the First World War to our times as well. Now, I mentioned the Lusitania. This is a very famous recruiting poster that the United States Army and its people came up with. It came up with this poster, though, not in 1917. This poster is 1915, and that's very important. What the Lusitania did that was crucially important to this story, it ended the American illusion that this war would not impact the United States. What it did was force Americans to begin to answer a very difficult question. What do you want to do about this crisis? Whereas a year before, in 1914, Americans could argue, as many Europeans once did, that the war will be quick and it won't affect us. By May of 1915, when the Lusitania is sunk by German torpedoes, there is no question but that this war will affect the United States. What do you want to do? And again, it should come as little surprise that Americans did not agree on that answer. The American ambassador to Great Britain, Walter Hines Page, wrote to Woodrow Wilson. He said, "We may soon have to have a great army and a great navy." And it's important to understand that when Walter Hines Page wrote those words, he meant them negatively. He meant that the United States was going to have to spend money on something it had never had to spend money on before. Later in that same letter, Page said, "We can build one battleship a year, or we can build one university a year." And it was obvious which of the two he preferred. The sinking of the Lusitania and the events of 1915 and 1916 ended this era of near-perfect U.S. security, from Europe at least. This poster is part of something called the Preparedness Movement, which I'll talk about in just a bit, a largely private initiative. The United States government, also for reasons that I'll talk about here, responded slowly, mostly because, you'll be surprised to hear this, dysfunction in the U.S. Congress, partisanship, debates about which way to go, and debates about the difference between the federal level and the state level. Can I have the next slide, please? This is an illustration from Life magazine. It shows the great armies of the world in 1915. That's Russia on the far left. On the far right is little tiny Uncle Sam with his rifle shouting out, "Me too!" The question is, do you want to build an army the size of the European armies? If you do want to build an army like that, how do you want to build it? And third, the question that army supporters had the hardest time answering on Capitol Hill, if you build this army, what exactly do you plan to do with it? Remember, the American army had never deployed this far from home before. What do you want to do with it? Well, one thing you could do, and the analogy that many Americans used, you could build what they called the Great American Porcupine. That is, you could build an animal that is no threat to any other animal. I don't actually know if this is true. I'm a city kid. But can easily defend itself. What you could do is build an army to prepare to defend your interests, but not an army that could be expeditionary. That's one thing you could do. Second, how would you want to build this army? Oh, I'm sorry, there's another way that you could do this. There were advocates 100 years ago who said what the United States Army ought to do is build a gigantic coastal artillery capability. What you ought to do is build something. I see people shaking their heads. You must have been artillery people. What you ought to do is develop a system based on the old fortification systems so that the United States can defend its coastlines and build mobile coastal artillery batteries that can go up and down the east and west coast and do whatever it is they might need to do. This would take away a role from the Navy, as John will talk about in a little bit, to let the Navy go and not have to worry about being brown water or green water. Or you could build an expeditionary army, capable of being sent anywhere in the world to meet any crisis wherever it might happen. And as I don't have to remind the people in this room, those are three very different capabilities, three very different kinds of armies, and three very different requests for funding. Now, even if you want to do that, even if you can agree on which of those three, how do you want to build this army? There are people like the former President Theodore Roosevelt, General Leonard Wood, the Senator Henry Cabot Lodge, who said that what the United States ought to do is go to a European-style conscription, what was then called UMT, Universal Military Training. There is very little support for this plan in the Senate or among the American people more generally. There's another option. You could stay within the existing National Guard structure, that is, work within the existing 48 state militias. And as I'll explain in just a minute here, the senior officers of the regular army thought that was the worst of all possible worlds. The third way you could do this is the way that the Americans had typically done it. Wait until there is a declaration of war and then call for volunteers. Each of these systems has advantages. Each of these systems has clear disadvantages. And as I hope to show you here, disagreement over this is one of the main reasons the United States Army wasn't ready. Can I have the next slide, please? Now, again, as I don't have to remind anybody in this room, the motto of the institution where I work, the U.S. Army War College, is not to prepare for war, but to preserve peace. This is the idea of Elihu Root. This is the idea of many of the senior American officers who want to create that porcupine type of army. What they argue is that the United States risks falling into the same kind of experience that China had fallen into in the 19th century, a rich country unable to defend itself that's at risk of being picked apart by avaricious Europeans. So what you should do is build an army that can defend the nation, not worry about the type of an army that could be expeditionary. So you see things like this. This is February 1916. A peace army of 1 million young men in waiting. This is from the New York Tribune. A plan by which the country is always prepared, but on a peace basis. The argument being that what you would do is create an army that can defend the United States, that would have lots of men trained in the rudiments of military service, but not trained, not equipped, not capable of deploying overseas. It's a popular idea inside the United States. You could build an army without asking the uncomfortable question, are you really going to send that army onto the Western Front? Is that really what you intend to do, General? The United States, of course, at this point was largely a status quo power, at least in relation to the great European powers. And the United States, many Americans at any rate, saw very little reason in 1916 to risk sending the American Expeditionary Force or an American Expeditionary Force over there. Now, this system, as many of you have probably already guessed, will eventually produce in the 1916 National Defense Act the Reserve Officer Training Corps program to do exactly this. Next slide, please. But given the inability of the United States government to do anything, private industry stepped up. And I think this is a crucial point, and it's a point that I make in the book that Tim was kind enough to mention. American private citizens, from Theodore Roosevelt all the way down, began to say, if the U.S. government is too gridlocked, too sclerotic, and too partisan to figure out what to do, we will do it ourselves. Now, some of you know about the Plattsburgh movement, where young men, usually young men of privilege, volunteered to go up to makeshift camps in Plattsburgh, New York, and elsewhere to learn how to become officers. Nobody thought that plan was sufficient to train officers. What they wanted the Plattsburgh movement to do was to shame Woodrow Wilson into doing something at the federal level. If the best America can do is a bunch of Yale and Harvard graduates running around the woods, then the president has to act. Now, Plattsburgh is the most famous of these examples, but it's far from the only one. Thomas Edison created a Committee of American Scientific Preparedness to organize American scientists. He did this in 1916, before American entry into the war. The famous Dr. Charles Mayo of the Mayo Clinic created a Committee on American Medical Preparedness. Columbia University, whose president was a pacifist, sent a letter out to Columbia faculty in 1916 describing the American Army's staff system, G1 through 6 or whatever it was in 1916, and asking the members of the Columbia faculty to identify where on that G-staff system their talents best fit in the event of a national emergency. And every single member of the Columbia faculty did it. This AT&T ad that's on the left is fairly typical. I love this ad. This is from 1916. It says, "We are prepared." The small picture in the circle on the left-hand side there is Paul Revere. The date says 1776. On the right is a U.S. Army staff officer on the telephone in front of a map of the AT&T telephone system. And the text reads, "In its wonderful preparedness to inform its citizens of a national need, the United States stands alone and unequaled. It can command the entire Bell telephone system, which completely covers our country with its network of wires." And the message is clear. The Bell telephone system is the new Paul Revere. If the government won't do it, we'll do it. And then this ad, which I just loved on the right-hand side, this is an ad for a company to help make your son fit. Show your boy how to develop his body. Home gymnastics, according to the Ling system. And there he is in soldier's uniform to get ready for what might come. Powell Evans, the great Philadelphia industrialist, led a plan, did not involve the government at all, to raise money to pay the salaries of any American workers who would volunteer to go through a program like this, whether Plattsburgh or just kind of health and physical fitness, right? Just in case the United States should find itself in an emergency. Again, the United States agreed on the need to prepare. What they could not agree on is what to prepare for and how exactly to do it. What role should the government play? What role should private industry play? And should Americans be worried about the concentration of wealth that might come along with it? John will talk a little bit more about the Navy, so I'm going to leave that alone. Could I have the next slide, please? This is a picture of a National Guard unit in 1916. Now, in 1916, most American professional soldiers looked at the National Guard as completely hopeless. 48 commanders in chief, 48 systems for training, 48 systems for equipping, and absolutely no coordination at the federal level. None. In the Pancho Villa expedition of 1916, when the federal government called for National Guard troops, one state called out convicts from its prison system to serve as National Guard troops. Another state, whose governor didn't like the expedition at all, demobilized his National Guard. Some National Guards and militias were used to break strikes. In all but two states, Illinois and New York, they were segregated. Now, to the Secretary of the Army, William Lindley Garrison, a lawyer from New Jersey, this was a completely insane way to govern national defense. Garrison was a progressive. 49 different systems, 49 different training regimens, and 49 different sets of equipment is unprogressive, inefficient, and bad. In early 1916, he proposed something that became known as the Continental Army Plan. At Carlisle Barracks, we have a Garrison Lane where most of the senior people live. I just assumed that that was for the garrison, the people who live there. It is, in fact, named for William Lindley Garrison for his support of this plan. Garrison's plan, the Continental Army Plan, would have broken up the National Guards and gotten rid of them entirely. It would have grown the U.S. Army by 40%, and it would have created a 400,000-man Army Reserve commanded and controlled from Washington, completely out from the states. The U.S. Army itself, the senior uniformed leaders, wanted universal military training. They wanted to introduce a German or French or European-style conscription. The Senate ended up saying it wouldn't pay for something like that and didn't want it, and President Wilson eventually said he wouldn't support the Continental Army Plan. In other words, nobody got anything that they wanted. What you got instead was something called the 1916 National Defense Act, which many of you I know in the room know a lot about. It created the Reserve Officer Training Corps program. It did create a larger U.S. Army, at least on paper. That army didn't grow for another year. And it did federalize the National Guard in the event of an emergency. It gave the president the authority. However, it absolutely forbade any form of conscription. It forbade any use of federal money to create anything in industry. Industry had to remain completely private. And the other thing that it did, which drove Lindley Garrison absolutely crazy, it took federal defense dollars and gave them to the states so that the states could upgrade their training and equipment programs. In other words, precious federal defense dollars were going to go not to modernize the U.S. Army, they were going to go to the states. And you can already probably guess why. There were 48 governors who hated the Continental Army Plan, and there were about 400 members of Congress that hated the Continental Army Plan. So the compromise was to create a National Guard under one system. Now, of course, it's impossible to do that quickly. Garrison was so furious with President Wilson that he not only resigned, he wrote a letter of resignation to the American media. This is in a presidential election year, by the way. His deputy, Henry Breckinridge, also resigned. So this is a big deal. Next slide, please. There was also this idea of just doing what you did in 1898. Wait until the crisis hits, and then do this by volunteers. And the most important advocate of this was William Jennings Bryan, the former Secretary of State, who had resigned. In other words, there were two major cabinet resignations from Woodrow Wilson over national defense issues. Garrison's in 1916, and William Jennings Bryan's in 1915. Bryan wanted Wilson to ban Americans from traveling overseas if they were at risk of being killed in another Lusitania incident. Wilson wouldn't do it. Bryan resigned. A little later on, Bryan said that the United States Army didn't need a draft, and it didn't need the Continental Army Plan. All it needed to do in the event of an emergency was call for 1 million men in arms, and they would have them by sundown. Now, this is a cartoon that is lampooning that. The cartoon says, illustrating the fact that this country could raise 1 million men in arms between sunrise and sunset. And you can see them here, showing up in their 1898 uniforms, showing up with pitchforks instead of rifles. Right? The idea to professionals is laughable, especially to people like Theodore Roosevelt and to the professionals of the United States Army. Next slide, please. So what you end up with is this cartoon from the New York World. The bastions there are the United States government, and they are very well protected, so no nasty people get in. And outside the breastworks, as it says there, are the two men whose ideas did not come to fruition. That is William Jennings Bryan on the left. He's holding a birdcage with a dove that has flown away, representing peace. And on the right-hand side is William Lindley Garrison holding a briefcase there that reads Continental Army. And they're both outside the breastworks. So what ends up happening by late 1916, the conservatives don't get the universal military training that they wanted, the progressives don't get the system that they wanted, and William Jennings Bryan on the left doesn't get the system that he wants either. The United States is going to go to war with a hodgepodge of all of these things put together. The 1916 National Defense Act is a really bad compromise, or as my dissertation advisor used to like to say, it's the perfect compromise because everybody hated it. The ROTC is created. The United States did get a larger Navy. Again, I'll leave that to my distinguished colleague from Newport. The Army grew to a theoretical maximum of 186,000 men, but nobody expected it to get anywhere near there. The National Guard would grow in theory to 400,000 men. Again, nobody expected it ever to get there. The president got the right to call up those troops and federalize them in event of a national emergency, but precious federal funds that should have gone to the National Army went to modernization for the National Guard. My last slide, and then I'll yield the floor. Could I have it, please? What that meant was the United States government was left to improvise in 1917. This is a wonderful cartoon, also from New York City, from the New York Globe. It says, building them up at the 11th hour, and what you have there is Congress serving as the butcher. And then you have the Army and Navy represented by the two cute little puppies in the bottom right-hand corner there, while Kaiser Wilhelm comes in through the window. And Congress says to them, quick, boys, wolf this down and sick 'em. And each of those pieces of meat is a quick appropriations bill that they're trying to pass through. And the little puppies down there are labeled dogs of war. Right? Now, again, I like political cartoons because they convey a message. They can convey a complicated message very quickly. What it means is the United States Army of 1917 was neither fish nor fowl, to keep the butcher metaphor going. It was neither a federalized, centralized system like the French Army, nor was it entirely a localized army, as the 48 governors of the United States had hoped that it would be. As a result, it is this process, not any ideas of isolation or any ideas of trying to ignore the war in Europe, that created an American army that was unable to deploy quickly and that took about a year to begin to make its impact felt in Europe. It also meant that the National Guard units would have to be a part of this process. And again, I know I don't have to remind the folks in this room, but maybe just as a quick reminder, most of the divisions that went overseas in World War I were National Guard divisions. So anything numbered over, I think it's 10 or 9, are National Guard divisions. So my home state of Pennsylvania was the 28th Division, New England is 26, so on and so on. Michigan and Ohio, 32. I think the last thing Michigan and Ohio agreed on. But the National Guard system had to be a part of this overall defense plan. So in conclusion, I'd like to leave you with 3 points. The first is that this period of the First World War is unbelievably complex, and reducing it down to simple answers, reducing it down to the textbook answers my daughter had, leaves us less well prepared, not just to understand the First World War, but to understand what it means for today. Second, whether we like it or not, and it's a discussion we have in Carlisle or not, a lot, politics matter. Defense policy is not just about an outside threat, it is about the domestic political environment. The reason the Continental Army Plan had no chance of succeeding is because it threatened the power of 48 governors and an awful lot of members of the United States House of Representatives. And third, culture matters. I didn't get much of a chance to talk about it in this brief time that I have here, but part of the reason the Continental Army Plan failed is that Lindley Garrison did not make any distinctions as to race. The National Reserve was going to be completely integrated. And for that reason, as you can probably guess, most governors and most members of the U.S. House of Representatives and U.S. Senate, both North and South, thought that the plan was unacceptable. Let me leave you before I turn it over to my colleagues here, just as a reminder, as we go through this centennial period and anniversary period, if you hear any easy answers about what the First World War was and what it did, that answer is probably wrong. Simple answers require simple solutions. Complex questions require extremely complex answers, and nothing is more complex than the First World War. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right, thank you. It's an honor to be here. I have to apologize. First of all, I do have Prussian ancestors, so the timeliness is extremely important to me, but the time of the event was changed and I wasn't informed. So fortunately, I was able to get my PowerPoint in online and get things going. I think, yeah, there it's started. I'm also honored to be speaking with my colleagues, Tim Nanninger, Mike Neiberg, and John Maurer, and also with respect to the U.S. Army. The Army Historical Foundation was kind enough to award me a Distinguished Writing Award for my book Thunder and Flames last year, but I suspect it's because I was a little bit hard on the Marines in that book. Pardon me. So I will be talking a bit about that here today. Let's see if this works. Next slide, please. So I have to start with a guy who I've built much of my career upon, George Washington, even though I've spent a good deal of time trying to get away from him. He's defined so much of what I've done over the past 20 years, but there is a concordance to be made here. When I was at a conference on the Revolutionary War this past weekend, I was honored to speak with, to hear a talk by my colleague John Grenier, who was an Air Force lieutenant colonel, who spoke about the Battle of Braddock's defeat in the French and Indian War in July of 1755 and its influence on future American military doctrine. And indeed, the idea of a peculiarly American way of war goes all the way back. I would argue that in many respects, it dates to 1755. Now, very briefly, I'm here to talk about World War I and the U.S. Army, not the French and Indian War. But very briefly, that encounter, for those of you who may not have heard of it, was led by a British general named Edward Braddock. Two regiments of British regulars led into the wilderness, then wilderness of western Pennsylvania, accompanied by American irregulars, including George Washington, Horatio Gates, and the rest, which are not regularly commissioned in the British Army at that time, and provincial troops. They were attacked from multiple directions by primarily Native American, but also French and French-Canadian troops, and they were soundly and bitterly defeated. Now, Washington's own lesson from this battle was that the British troops failed because they were indisciplined. And recent scholarship has shown that, in fact, they followed military doctrine of the time to the T. And they worked very effectively in moving into the wilderness, but they were defeated in some ways by circumstances beyond their control. But Washington saw that when these British troops came under pressure, they broke because their discipline failed under pressure. That was his lesson. He took that to the idea in the Revolutionary War of a conventional war. But that was very different from the popular view, and it was indeed a view that came to have a huge influence on our military ideas even to this day. The concept that the British didn't know how to hide behind trees, and we did. So it's, even I have friends at West Point who talk about it that way, you know, when they have cadets who come in, they have to disabuse them of that first thing, that idea that we Americans are the only ones who know how to hide behind trees, and that George Washington said, "Let me go, General Braddock, and lead the troops into the woods and fight as the Indians do," and Braddock brushes him aside, said, "No, we shall follow European methods of combat and discipline," and that's why they're slaughtered. So this idea became pervasive in many respects. Next slide, please, if this works. This idea became pervasive in many respects as the United States entered the First World War. Generals for whom I have tremendous respect, including John Pershing, Charles Summerall, pictured here, believed, like many of their predecessors and many who followed them, that they were bringing a new ingredient to combat in the European theater in 1917. Pershing spoke at great length about how the trench warfare and combat up to that point had not only demoralized, but he used the word corrupted, the French and the British and even the Germans, and that what we brought to the mix was a freshness, a vitality, an understanding that we could transcend this war of the trenches, not become addicted to artillery and grenades and machine guns, but return our focus to the concept of the individual soldier and his rifle. Now, Charles Summerall, as my colleague Tim Neninger has pointed out in his own scholarship, was an advocate of the use of massed artillery, and he was one of the pioneers in that. But in many ways, he was an outsider in some respects, and his idea failed to gain traction early enough. And because of the lack of American military mobilization early enough, we didn't have the resources to mobilize enough artillery to bring it to the fore. And what we ultimately did rely on, and U.S. Army training and Marine training, I should add, really did focus on the concept of the individual soldier or the individual Marine with his rifle and his superior marksmanship, and especially his superior individual initiative as being the factor that would win the war. Sorry, next slide. One of the repercussions of this was a pronounced reluctance to learn from our French and British associated powers as we arrived at the front. Again, much the same language was used, and this appears in multiple official documents, as I've seen are available in the National Archives. This concept that we should learn to a limited degree from the French and the British, but we should be careful not to attach our concepts and doctrine too closely to what they were trying to impart, because ultimately it would return us to the trenches, it would corrupt the doughboys and the Marines morally, and would just limit their ability to be effective on the front. Now, one of the myths of the war, myth I have to say I completely bought into for a long time, is the idea that the British and French advocated amalgamation, and that we utterly and completely resisted them in every respect. Let's see, next slide, please. We utterly and completely resisted them in every respect and refused to fight under British or French command. That's simply not true. It certainly is true that General Pershing fought along under instructions from Wilson and Secretary of War Newton Baker, fought for the creation of an independent American army under American command, which eventually came to pass in August of 1918. But up to that time, from November of 1917, when the first American troops enter the front line, up through the end of through the middle of August 1918, for the most part, American troops are fighting under French and British command, even if they're not actually wearing French or British uniforms in most cases. Now, the integration of American troops, particularly into French forces, which is what I studied in my book, proceeds from the level literally of platoon up to regiment and even brigade level and, of course, division level. So, in fact, American troops did fight under French command, but the collaboration was not an easy one. It was profoundly uneven. I love this picture, particularly for the soldier on the right side who is looking with tremendous skepticism at these gas masks. He's like, are you really expecting me to put this thing on? That was, again, one of the issues that we had was this skepticism of the ideas even of using gas masks, although the disproportionate number of American casualties from gas is a complex matter. It's not easy just to boil down to not using gas masks, although that was part of it. Next slide, please. In March 1918, the Germans launched the first of a series of final offensives on the Western Front, Operation Michael, March 21st. There is much that I could say about this. I'm not going to get into detail in the brief time that I have available, but it is ultimately the offensive that brings American troops into the war on a large scale. The Germans had conducted raiding parties against American troops from the 1st and the 26th Divisions from the fall of 1917 to the spring of 1918 with varied success. But their larger offensives in March 1918 led to a perception of panic, a perception of vulnerability both from the Western allies, France and Britain, to the associated power, the United States, that the Western Front was indeed about to collapse. Sir Douglas Haig, Field Marshal Haig, issued his famous backs to the wall order in April of 1918, I believe it was. Next slide. Oh, there we go. This was the result of one of the first German raids against American troops in the fall of 1917. Next slide. Stubby the war dog, we'll leave him aside for the moment. Next slide. The first American, large-scale American entry into the war was at the Battle of Cantigny. There's a new book out by Matt Davenport about the Battle of Cantigny in late May of 1918. And this battle was a relatively small-scale affair. It was aimed after the German offensives had begun to weaken, again, almost entirely from French and British resistance. There was a push to launch American troops in an offensive direction as opposed to simply holding the line as the troops of the 3rd Division would do on the Marne. Cantigny is one of these somewhat overblown engagements of the U.S. Army. It was a small village situated below heights that were actually tactically the more important elements of that terrain in that area. However, this attack of the 1st Division was launched in what I can only say was a rather staged manner. For the publicity that it would impart that American troops were ready and willing to fight. Now, the Americans, in collaboration with French engineers using flamethrowers, some French tanks, and the rest were initially quite effective in capturing Cantini, breaking through the German defenses, which was one thing that was very much publicized. However, in the aftermath, German counterattacks very nearly broke the American lines, which had been poorly placed. Next slide, please. Now, Belleau Wood, which is what I'm going to concentrate on here today, although even then I'm not going to say too much about it. Belleau Wood has been one of those kind of central elements, central episodes in the American war effort that has been publicized tremendously. Those of you who have been down at Quantico and that superb museum there may have noticed, we moved ahead to General de Gaulle, may have noticed this movie that they have there of the American assault at Belleau Wood in early June of 1918. The idea presented there and the idea that's presented in just about every account of the Marines in the war that I could find, including some really excellent accounts by books by George Clark that have a great deal of firsthand material in there, present the concept that the Germans were driving on Paris in June of 1918 with an intent to capture Paris, and that American troops, and specifically the Marines in the 2nd Division, which, by the way, did have an army brigade, although that's not generally remembered today. It did have an army brigade, but that the Marines were inserted into the line with the army troops kind of tagging along behind, and that they stopped the Germans first at Les Marais Farm on June 3rd, 1918, and then counterattacked on June 6, 1918 at Belleau Wood and shattered the German offensive. Now, there are just a few things I'll say about this because it kind of encapsulates in many ways the American military experience in the First World War and how the Army developed, and then I'm going to bring it back to that idea of individual initiative, and this is one area where my thinking has really changed, and I want to talk just briefly about alliance warfare. Now, the first thing to emphasize is that French and German primary sources show quite conclusively that some of the initial meeting encounters that have been described, such as at Les Marais Farm, as the first encounters of American and German troops in large-scale combat, in fact, never happened, or most likely never happened. The first accounts of Les Marais Farm that you'll find described in much literature, including fairly recently in some articles in the New York Times, suggests that the Germans advanced in massed ranks for whatever reason, despite the fact this is 1918 and German troops had learned a little bit by this time. But still, in most popular accounts that you'll see, they suggest that they advanced in massed ranks and that the Americans, with kind of shades of the BEF in 1914, mowed them down in heaps, primarily with rifle fire and by their ability to position themselves and take cover effectively. In fact, German and French sources show that the French troops, who, according to legend, had been retreating in disarray at the time, actually were fighting viciously and themselves stopped the German advance, which was never directed against Paris, but was more intended to establish a defensive position where they could situate themselves and prepare for the counterattack. But that, in fact, what happened was that the Marines came into line, relieved large numbers of French troops, and then counterattacked with terrible results. Next slide. And let's see. There we go. One back, please. There we go. Okay. In Belleau Wood, the Marines attacked initially in parade ground formation. There had been suggestions that they attempt to use infiltration tactics, which were not unknown to the Americans at that time. They were not unknown. Instead, they did advance in parade ground formation with astonishing discipline and astonishing bravery. The Germans were indeed shocked by the ability of the Americans to keep coming despite their horrendous losses and indeed their great determination to continue to fight no matter what losses they took. But their losses were tremendous and unnecessary. I argue in my book that the back of the Marine Division, the Marine Brigade, was essentially broken in bellow wood to no great purpose thanks to the mistakes of some commanders such as General Harbord. Once the Marines began to establish themselves in bellow wood, however, they began to learn tactics and began to learn them on the job. And I just have a couple more points and then I'll finish up because these things kind of encapsulate some larger points. They began to learn their tactics very effectively, and one of the signs of that, and they were fighting in a place in Bellow Wood where command control was next to impossible. It was really up to individual Marines and junior officers to take initiative on their own because of the nature of the woods themselves, the thickness of the woods, the gas, the distance back to command posts and all the rest. They began to improvise on their own, and one of the interesting signs of that is that if you read the manuscript sources, when the Marines first enter the woods, they're the victim of German dirty tricks. Now, you all know what the battlefield dirty tricks are, the things that nobody wants to talk about, or if they do talk about them, they treat them as these horrific atrocities, and they're, in fact, very much a part of warfare. Now, the Marines were victimized by German dirty tricks, such as yelling out in English, bugle calls for American bugle calls, all the rest, even donning American uniforms. And yes, they did do that. If you read German sources, within a week to 10 days of the time the Marines have entered the woods, they start doing the same thing. And the Germans become victimized by very, very much the same dirty tricks. Now, compare this, nevertheless, to just next door, Bellow Wood, there was a unit of the, or actually a number of platoons and company level forces of the U.S. Army 3rd Division, 30th Regiment, that had been inserted with French troops and were following French tactics to take German-held high ground right next to Bellow Wood. Following these tactics, which were essentially bite-and-hold tactics, advance cautiously at night through the woods, hold ground, and then let the Germans attack you, and let the Germans take tremendous casualties, which they did, and then creep forward again over and over, they captured that ground with minimal casualties. The Marines pushed forward with terrible casualties in Bellow Wood, and when this was one of the things that rather bothered me when a regiment of the U.S. Army, 7th Regiment, was inserted into Bellow Wood, the attitude was essentially sink or swim. There was very little inter-service cooperation, I have to say, in the summer, the spring and summer of 1918. Again, both branches of the service showed tremendous bravery and ability to adapt under fire, but there was less collaboration than one would have liked. However, by the end, by the time the Marines do break through in Bellow Wood, the way they break through is going right back, and this is where I'm ending, right back to the idea of Pershing's idea, dating to the idea of the American way of war, of individual initiative. And this is one of the things that I find terribly ironic, and I have to say a mea culpa for, to some degree, was when I first wrote about the First World War, I was very hard on Pershing. And very hard on this concept of the individual soldier with his rifle. But when you study the Battle of Bellow Wood, and in certain places, and again, it happens again to some degree at Soissons, it happens to some degree in the Meuse-Argonne, in the Argonne Forest in particular, when command control broke down, you can see Marines and soldiers taking these concepts of individual initiative to heart. Now, when the Marines find this small ravine that works into a junction of two German divisions in Bellow Wood, they exploit that junction and that ravine under no orders from staff officers, nor indeed even that I could find from field officers, but individual Marines broke through and exploited and worked their way behind and destroyed the German defenses and pushed all the way through. So if you look at the overall arc of American military participation, there's so much more that I could say, and I'm sorry in this brief time that I have. You see certainly tremendous losses, and I always have to say the caveat, incredible bravery, because I've been criticized at times by those who suggest that I'm putting down the American soldier, which I'm not. Tremendous bravery, but lack of preparedness and poor training. But as you follow American combat through World War I, through the summer, there were many encounters through the summer and into the fall, you see exceptional adaptability, an exceptional ability to learn quickly is one of the ongoing characteristics of American armed forces throughout history, but also a return to that concept of the American way of war that I started with. That concept that in some ways that individual initiative at times of crisis is indeed what carries the soldier through. Thank you.
Let me start by thanking General Sullivan, General Swan, Mark for inviting me to this event today. And what I want to talk about is a strategic perspective, if you will, on the American participation in the First World War. So what are some of the longer trends of history? What are some of the big drivers that are driving the international system of the time that leads to this collision? War between the United States and Imperial Germany. Well, first I want to go back a couple generations to the middle of the 19th century, to wars of national unification that were taking place in the middle of the 19th century, both in Europe and in North America. Of course, our great Civil War, that great war in American history, where the United States became a much more powerful country because we fought a war amongst ourselves to unite our country, to create a more perfect union, and also to establish a stronger democracy. Meanwhile, in Central Europe, you have what I like to call the War of Prussian Aggression, sort of like the War of Northern Aggression, as Southerners like to call it. Well, this is certainly the War of Northern Aggression. Well, the aggression of the North German state of Prussia, which creates a greater Prussia, which we call Imperial Germany. Three wars, 1864 against Denmark, 1866 against Austria, and 1870-71, the Franco-Prussian War, in which a Prussian-led Germany proves victorious. These wars in Central Europe and in North America set the stage because these two countries have become stronger and more powerful and are going to emerge in the early 20th century as great rivals, as successors, potential successors to a British-led world. And of course, we think of Spotsylvania, American soldiers north and south fighting it out. Meanwhile, the Battle of Königgrätz happening 2 years later in 1866 with the Prussians beating the Austrians, the largest battles of the 19th century, near Battle of Encirclement. We look at the military leaders, let me go back, think about Appomattox, surrender of Lee, 1865 in April, and then in September of 1870, Louis Napoleon captured at Sedan by the German army, and there's Bismarck with Louis Napoleon. Louis doesn't look too happy, does he, being a prisoner of war. Bismarck, of course, was perfectly willing to negotiate with him if he could have. But Louis Napoleon refused to negotiate away Alsace-Lorraine. And in January of 1871, the German Empire is proclaimed. And where is it proclaimed? in the Hall of Mirrors in Versailles, in the outskirts of Paris. And here you see German generals saluting the new Kaiser and Bismarck front and center in his white uniform. Again, remember that the German Empire is forged in war, a victorious war over France in 1870 and 71. The political leadership, these iconic figures of the wars of unification. Bismarck, of course, on the left, the Iron Chancellor, and on the right, Lincoln, the Great Emancipator. These iconic political leaders, one fighting wars to try to preserve a conservative, oligarchic, anti-parliamentary form of government in Prussia. And the other, in Abraham Lincoln, trying to create, as I said, that more perfect union to spread democracy. The words, of course, of our Gettysburg Address that Lincoln gave. Again, this is setting the stage for a collision that's going to happen at the beginning of the 20th century. And of course, the military leaders we've heard about, well, is the concept of strategic culture, does it really exist? An American way of war is represented by U.S. Grant, a Prussian-German way of war, of wanting to win quickly, quick victories on the battlefield leading to political outcomes, the Clausewitz, the Moltke, Helmut von Moltke point of view, Helmut von Moltke maybe being one of the greatest generals, if not the greatest general, of 19th century Europe on the right. Again, these armies, these countries are being positioned for wars of the 20th century. Well, coming to the end of the 19th and early part of the 20th century is an age much like today, an age of rise and fall of great powers, of a changing international system that's taking place. Nothing stays the same. Things change. The international system, though, when you have rising powers, as happened back at the end of the 19th and early 20th century, the international relations scholars will tell you it creates great turbulence in the international system that highlights, underscores the potential for war and conflict. We all like to think that rising powers want to become, what do we call China? We want them to become a responsible stakeholder, right? That's what we want, China to be a... Maybe they don't want to be a responsible stakeholder. Maybe they want to create their own system, and their own image. Why should they be subordinate to the existing international order? Well, that is what's happening in the beginning of the 20th century. Now, who are those rising powers? Well, at this time, remember that Britain is the leading state. And this is coins from 1806, at the time of the Napoleonic Wars. And what do you see on the coin? Well, on the left-hand side, you see George III, our last king, right? America's last king. And on the right-hand side, you see Britannia sitting there with the trident, olive branch of peace. In the background, well, ships. Trade. Trade creates wealth. That wealth has to be protected by a royal navy. Britain is the dominant trading state in the world, hence it's also a wealthy state. And it has become a great industrial power because Britain is not only a great trading state, but it is also the workshop of the world. It's pioneering at the end of the 18th and early 19th century, the Industrial Revolution. Here you see the Crystal Palace in the 1850s, a big exhibit that is being put on in London. In 1870, think about this for a moment. 2% of the world's population is accounting for this. Again, Britain is seen as the workshop of the world, the leading industrial technological power of its time. Well, fast forward another generation. Well, you're going to see a challenge. And of course, Britain is also the global superpower. It is the superpower. Britain's like the boast that the sun never set on the British Empire. Later, Kaiser Wilhelm said, we want our place in the sun, too. We also want to have that empire upon which the sun never sets. When you look at this in this way, this projection, what you see, of course, is Britain, the small isles off the coast of Europe, the great dominion to the north, Canada. But you can see how Britain is, its empire is very much, its center of gravity is located in Asia. It's an Indian Ocean littoral empire stretching from New Zealand, Australia, through Southeast Asia, Hong Kong, Singapore, South Asia, modern-day India, Pakistan, all the way down to South Africa. In fact, in 1939, the famous journalist John Gunther, who is remembered for his book about his son's, Johnny's death, Death Be Not Proud. A journalist writing about Asia wrote and said, again in 1939, well, we all know that the greatest power in Asia is Britain. We tend to think, well, no, the greatest power in Asia has to be what, China? Has to be Japan? No, the greatest power in Asia is Britain. Well, the British Empire is soon going to be challenged by what we today call the rise of the rest. Now, who are those rising powers back then? Well, here's one photograph that shows it. Here you see Theodore Roosevelt and Kaiser Wilhelm in 1910 at German army maneuvers. President Roosevelt had stepped down as president in March 1909. He was in Europe in May of 1910. He had gone to Europe to receive the Nobel Peace Prize. He received the Nobel Peace Prize for the role he played in helping to broker a deal between Russia and Japan, ending the Russo-Japanese War of 1904-1905, the famous Treaty of Portsmouth, New Hampshire. Well, Theodore Roosevelt, while in Europe, gave lectures in Paris and also in Berlin, and the Kaiser invited him to German army maneuvers in May of 1910. And so there they are on horseback together. Now, the Kaiser's photographer took these photographs. And then the Kaiser sent these photographs to Theodore Roosevelt. And underneath each of the photographs, the Kaiser wrote in his own hand, a message to Theodore Roosevelt. Here's one of the photographs. And underneath, this is what Wilhelm wrote. Remember, Kaiser Wilhelm is the grandson of Queen Victoria, fluent in English, and you can all read that, right? Oh, you're better than I am. Well, I was going to make it easy for you. There it is, the colonel of the Rough Riders lecturing the chief of the German army. And you can imagine Theodore Roosevelt lecturing Kaiser Wilhelm. I can imagine Kaiser Wilhelm lecturing Theodore Roosevelt, too. In their own time, they were often compared to each other. You know, we have Theodore Roosevelt way up there on Mount Rushmore. You know, he's one of our national icons, national hero, and we don't like the idea of comparing him to Kaiser Wilhelm. After all, Kaiser Wilhelm was defeated and ended up in exile, the farmer of Doorn in the Netherlands. Well, here's another photograph, and here's what it says. Total agreement, again, this is what the Kaiser's writing to Theodore Roosevelt, total agreement about the general maxims on life and policy between America, notice it's spelled with a K, and Germany. Well, we know full well there is no total agreement here about between these two rising powers on the world stage. In fact, there's great disagreement. The disagreement between Germany and the United States is going to result in two world wars. Within 7 years, American and German troops will be fighting each other on the seas, in the Atlantic, and also on land on the Western Front. And of course, they'll be fighting again, a second world war. So these two rising powers on the world stage, while in some ways they're challengers to Britain, they're also challengers to each other as well. Now, there's a big takeaway there, isn't there, for our own time when we think about the rise of China on the world stage. Who are going to also be China's adversaries on the world stage as it rises? Threatens not just the United States and our position in Asia, but also other countries in Asia as well, India, Japan, Vietnam. Well, how do you measure rising powers? Well, right away, we tend to go right away the economics. And this comes from Paul Kennedy's famous book, 1987, The Rise and Fall of Great Powers. And what you see, if you measure energy consumption, and that's one good measure still used today to measure industrial power, also the technological prowess of a society, what you see is that the U.S. has emerged as an industrial equal in some way to Britain. Britain is no longer the workshop of the world. There's another workshop of the world out there. It's the United States. And in 1893, I'm jumping ahead here somehow. I'm going to go back. Okay. In 1893, the Great Columbian Exhibition that takes place in Chicago. Again, this is like Britain's Crystal Palace of the 1850s. It's to highlight American technological industrial prowess on the world stage, a remarkable achievement of its time. And again, that Americans are conscious that somehow they have pulled even with Britain as a great industrial power. Fast forward to 1913 on the eve of the Great War, and what you see is what? That Germany is pulling abreast of Britain as an industrial power. But look at the United States' industrial potential relative to these other countries. It's greater than Germany and Britain together. And again, this is one of the most important aspects of the history of the last 100 plus years, is that the United States' role on the world stage has been undergirded, underpinned by our economic strength. The U.S. economy, being as large, as technologically advanced as it is, helps provide for the U.S. position on the world stage as a leading power on the world stage. Already before the First World War, the United States is an economic superpower, not yet a military superpower, but we're very much an economic superpower at this time. And Americans at the time are conscious of this. This is Brooks Adams, historian, publicist of the time, 1900, wrote a book called America's Economic Supremacy. Again, Americans are very much conscious and aware of the growth of the American economy at this time. Now, Brooks Adams, of course, being the grandson and great-grandson of American presidents, writing to his friend, Henry Cabot Lodge, this is what Brooks Adams had to say. England's sad, to him very sad, again, this is for an Anglophile, that Britain's position in the world is declining relative to other powers, including the United States. Again, for an Anglophile, hoping that Britain's fortunes would somehow revive. But the current is flowing away from Britain. Again, this is to Henry Cabot Lodge, this circle of American elites. And again, what's the result likely to be? As Britain weakens on the world stage, it will be less likely to be able to take part in what Brooks Adams calls the strenuous competition of the new world. Again, a new world order formed by rising powers on the world stage that want to reshape the international order in their own image. Alfred Thayer Mahan, and I hold the Alfred Thayer Mahan Chair at the Naval War College in Newport, Rhode Island. His famous books on the influence of sea power upon history, which were his lectures up at the schoolhouse in Newport, the first volume of which was published in 1890, and you'll see that, like Brooks Adams, he writes in saying that British power, national life, seems to be waning. This is 1890. Well, again, what are some of the implications of this? Well, for Theodore Roosevelt in 1911, that we, the United States, are becoming, given our strength, our geographical position, more and more the balance of power in the whole globe. Again, that the United States is moving to replace Britain somehow as the dominant world power and the power that can balance out other powers on the world stage. Contested commons. Today we think about the commons. We think about the maritime commons, the aerospace commons, information commons. We think about cyber warfare. Well, at this time, too, they're thinking about the commons. Mahan coining this phrase of the maritime world being that like a great commons, which trade, sea lines of communication go across, and that great powers struggle to control those great commons. And so what you see with these rising powers is a struggle for naval mastery as well. Again, Britain is the dominant naval power of the 19th century. Battle of Trafalgar, great painting by J.M.W. Turner, October 21st, 1805. I like the joke that half the safes in Britain are opened by that, 21-10-05. I don't know if it's true or not. Mike and I are thinking next time we're in England, we'll try it out. And of course, the Battle of Waterloo, 1806-15, opened the other half, so they say. Okay. Well, in 1897, at the time of Queen Victoria's Jubilee, again, Britain, that victory at sea over France and Spain in the Napoleonic Wars, it lasted down through the 19th century. And as late as 1897, what you see is this sense of unassailable supremacy. That with 360 major warships, what is it? The Royal Navy is equal to the next five navies combined. How often do we hear that today? That the U.S. defense budget at X number of billion dollars, 600, is equal to the next eight or nine. Around the world, right? You read that all the time? Does that make you feel secure? No, it shouldn't make you feel secure. Of course not. And indeed, that 360 number, that's the number the Navy would like to have now, up from 270. What is it about global powers that we need about 360 major combatants? But of course, in 1897, it looks unassailable. But within 20 years, Britain is fighting for its life to control the maritime commons against a German submarine menace that becomes the trigger that brings the U.S. into the Great War. So what seemed so comfortable and unassailable in 1897, within a short period of time, it's a very dangerous world because Germany is able to contest those maritime commons and fight it out with the British on the high seas. What are the implications for the U.S.? Well, if there's a waning of British power, what the great historian C. Van Woodward called the end of free security. We can't depend upon Britain to somehow protect us in the Western Hemisphere, so we have to build up our own naval power to control those maritime commons. Alfred Thayer Mahan, writing in a book, The Interest of America in International Affairs, wrote the dangers facing the United States. How do you meet those dangers? Well, you have to meet it outside your own territory at sea. Mike talked earlier about, you know, coastal fortifications. Well, the Navy's going to say, no, that's a defensive orientation. You want to be on the offense. On the commons, you want to be on the offense. You don't want to be on the defense. You want to seize the initiative. You know, Clausewitz famously wrote that defense is the stronger form of war. Well, not to Mahan and not to people on the maritime. It's the offense. You've got to strike at the enemy. Go to the enemy's home waters. You know, as George W. Bush liked to say, let's make it an away game, not a home game. And so for Mahan, the message is you must build up your naval power to keep the fight away from the coasts, not defend along the coast. In Newport, of course, we have Fort Adams that defends Narragansett Bay. You don't want to build Fort Adams. You want to build the Great White Fleet instead. If you have to choose how to spend your resources, your defense dollars. For Theodore Roosevelt, too, the implication is there's a correlation between the size of your Navy and also the role you're going to play. If the American people don't want to build up their Navy, it means the implication is that they're going to play a lesser role in world affairs. We'd like to talk a lot about soft power, and no one will deny that soft power is important in the world. Your appeal, your ideological appeal, the lifestyle that you have. These are very powerful forces. And yet at the same time, though, it has to be backed up by military might as well, that hard power. Well, what are the German dreams, too? It's not just the Americans that are the rising power. It's the Kaiser who wants to build up the big fleet as well, the high seas fleet, as he calls it, a fleet that was really meant to fight in German littoral home waters. But nonetheless, it goes with the nomenclature of high seas fleet. And the picture back, boy, I'm really leaping ahead here. Okay, there they are, building up the German high seas fleet. Britain responds with its own battle fleet. When the war comes in 1914, what do these two fleets of battleships do? Well, they run away from each other. The admirals are risk-averse, whereas on land, the armies collide with each other. We're all familiar with the great offensives of 1914. Everybody's on the offensive in 1914 on the ground. At sea, the big fleets of capital ships run away from each other. They stay away. And you have a stalemate on the major oceanic front, the North Sea. But of course, like all quiet on the Western Front, this is ironic. It's not quiet. There's a lot of fighting that goes on in the North Sea. It's just not the big fleets are fighting each other, the capital ships. Only the Battle of Jutland, May 31st, 1916, do you see the big fleets come together in the North Sea. Instead, the fleets, the big battle fleets stay away from each other. Now, this stalemate works to Britain's advantage. Today, we like to think about a strategy of offshore control, that if you have a conflict with China, that somehow you can blockade China from a distance. Well, basically, that's what Britain is doing in the Great War. The contested zone of the North Sea, there you don't want your big ships to go. But by imposing a blockade on Germany, you can hurt Germany by denying it imports of foodstuffs and raw materials. Try to control that trade while keeping your own trade open for the British. Now, the German response is the submarine, and here's the U-9. 1914, this celebrated submarine in Germany sinks four British cruisers, the Abacore, Cressy, and Hogue off the coast of Netherlands, and then the cruiser Hawk in the North Sea, British cruisers. Again, this is a sign that these new weapons, the submarine, how lethal it can be, the lethality of modern warfare at sea, mines, torpedoes, coastal artillery. The Germans are turning to this weapon to get at the British. Here's a postage stamp from the time. God strafe England. God punish England. And you can see the Dawn Patrol, the submarine heading out there. German propaganda at this time is that England's the main enemy. England is the one that's defeating us. Germany would win the war if it were not for British intervention. Then Germany, God is on our side. We're going to go after those British. Well, we heard about the Lusitania from Mike, how important that is in shaping opinion in the United States. Robert Ballard recently, about 10 years ago now, discovering the wreck, artist's rendition of what it looks like today. New York Times headline about it. For the Germans, naval leadership, the war is not going to be decided by the battleship fleet. It's going to be decided by an aggressive, unrestricted, all-out U-boat submarine offensive against English commerce. That's the way Britain will be brought to its knees. Admiral Holtzendorf, who is the chief of the naval staff, writes a very famous memorandum in December of 1916 saying that England's backbone has to be broken, and the backbone is its merchant fleet. Again, the Germans are very much aware that by doing this unrestricted submarine warfare, they're going to provoke war with the United States. They are not sleepwalking into war. They're very conscious of this. They've been debating it from 1914 down to 1917. And it all comes to a head on January 9th, 1917, at a big Crown Council in Silesia, in which the generals and the admirals and the Kaiser get together with the Chancellor, and it's decided to embark on unrestricted submarine warfare, knowing full well that it's likely to lead to war with the United States. Der Freischütz, famous German opera from the German Romantic movement of the early part of the 19th century. The story behind the Freischütz is that the man wants to win the hand of the fair lady, and to do it, he has to win a shooting contest. And so he sells his soul to get a special bullet that always hits its target, a precision-guided weapon, we would say. Okay, well, but you have to sell your soul to do it. And, of course, well, the Freischütz, it's the silver bullet. And what is the silver bullet? It's the German submarine. It's the way of thinking that somehow they can win. And here the German generals, Hindenburg, Ludendorff, are again with the Kaiser, and you can see at the hunting lodge, and again with the trophies from the hunting. This is very much ingrained in German culture, that we can somehow win with that silver bullet by the quick victory here. German chancellor says, hey, if the military naval authorities, he's boxed in. The generals have already gotten the Kaiser to agree that if the chancellor decides to stand against the submarine decision, then he'll be fired. Again, who's in charge in Berlin? It's German militarism. That's who's in charge in Berlin, calling the shots by early 1917. Well, again, we can think of island chains in the Western Pacific today, first island chain, second island chain. You can superimpose that sort of methodology onto the European theater. And, of course, Britain is trying to control those island chains, second and third. Well, the Germans with submarine forces are now striking out into the Atlantic to contest the maritime commons. There we go. The sinkings of the unrestricted submarine warfare that brings Germany into contest with the United States. These are paintings by Willy Steller, who is Kaiser Wilhelm, was one of his favorite painters because he did all this maritime art, submarine sinking ships, and the rest American ships, as you can see. Let's move on to the next one. And we'll move on. I'll be concluding in just a moment. Well, America goes to war, as we know, in April 1917. Back on the 2nd, Woodrow Wilson asking for a joint session of Congress declaration of war. And in his speech, he talks about how German submarine warfare is warfare against mankind. Credible when you think about it. that the United States is now going to project military power across to Europe. To be able to do that, you have to win control of that maritime commons. This is unthinkable. If in 1913, if you had said that, hey, within 5 years, the U.S. is going to send an expeditionary force of over 2 million men to Europe and then start bringing them back again, they would have said, what kind of imagination you have? You should be a good science fiction writer. That will never happen in the real world. And yet, that's exactly what happened with our destroyers playing a role in convoying ships across the Atlantic, convoys being one of the antidotes to the German submarine menace, building of merchant ship tonnage and the rest, the victory at sea. Admiral Sims, who's the commander of American naval forces in Europe, also president of the Naval War College both before and right after the First World War, wrote a Pulitzer Prize-winning book, The Victory at Sea, and there you see him with Assistant Secretary of the Navy Franklin D. Roosevelt. For those of you who are military historians, of course, you know full well that you can't understand the Second World War without understanding the history of the First World War. How much the leaders of the Second World War go through the whole list of them, how their experiences of war were shaped by the First World War. I love this photograph of Roosevelt because he's looking over in an admiring way at Sims, and yet at the same time, he looks like he's very cautious about him, too, at the same time. Well, let me conclude. Over there, the Yanks are coming. But a final note, when the United States goes to war, as we've gone to war since 1917, we have to think not just about the American way of war, but how the U.S. armed forces fight as part of a coalition. Our wars are coalition wars, much like the ancient Romans. When the Romans went to war, they always had their allies alongside of them when they fought. And the United States, too, in the great battles on the Western Front, we have to remember that we fought as part of a coalition to defeat Imperial Germany, and that the peacemaking that took place was also part of a negotiation with other countries. And let me end with this last slide, famous painting by Sir William Orpin of Versailles, The Hall of Mirrors. June 28, 1919, 5 years after Franz Ferdinand's assassination, there they are presenting the treaty, forcing, as the Germans would see it, to sign the Versailles Treaty. Unfortunately, that treaty didn't end the German-American rivalry. It would go on for a second stage in the Second World War. Thank you very much.
Sims is that he's not given very much instruction when he is sent over there. And in fact, he goes over before the war is declared. One of the things he finds out very quickly is just how desperate the Allied situation is. He writes his wife that he had dinner with Lady Randolph Churchill, Winston Churchill's mother. And at the dinner, Winston Churchill was. And so he wrote his wife to say, I had a long conversation with Winston Churchill, who has told us, who told me, that if we had not, the U.S. had not come into the war, Britain would have lost it. And this is in May of 1917. So one of the things he finds out is that the situation looks much more grim than what he had been led to believe. And so he's creating things out of whole cloth, staff and the rest. In fact, his uniform, he goes to Savile Row to get a uniform made for him at the recommendation of Admiral Jellicoe. So very much a lot of what's being done here is adaptation during the war. He sets up an incredible staff, though, The London planning staff is a remarkable group of officers that provide guidance for him. And the U.S. Navy, the 40 or so destroyers that we send over to European waters, play an important role in helping institute the convoy system and the rest. So, yes, a remarkable individual.
On the declaration of war in the U.S. Congress.
It's like, I think there's 50 dissents. There's 50 no's out of what must have been.
I think it was 82 to 6 in the Senate. It was like 373 to 50 in the House of Representatives.
One of the great stories, of course, is one of the representatives who votes against it is Jeanette Rankin, who in 1917, and she's also the only person to vote against the declaration of war on December 8, 1941. She has the distinction of voting against both world wars.
Well, it's obvious, gentlemen, that there are a lot of lessons out of World War I were lost in 35, 36, 37 as we move towards the Second World War. But what about 2017? What is the lesson for 2017 for the world, First World War in Europe?
Just one?
Come on, Mike, go for it.
I don't even know where to start. I think that, you know, I wrote a book in, you know, in which I argued that the world of 1914, although there were people that had problems with it, was a stable world, and that the real cause of the First World War is that the crisis created by the Archduke's assassination is not the crisis the great powers were ready for, and it's not what the system is built for. So John put up those slides of, you know, the German emperor being crowned in Versailles. This is not a war, World War I, that starts over something between France and Germany. France and Germany are sucked in accidentally. So I guess the great lesson would be that enormous wars can be caused by very small initial events and political miscalculation based on those events. And you have to be very, very careful with each step that you take, because as you all know in this room, once a war begins, it can be virtually impossible to get out. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Nobody in Europe. Well, let me rephrase it this way. I think if every leader in Europe in July of 1914 could have been shown what the world would look like in October 1914, not a single one of them would have gone to war.
Mm-hmm. The other thing was the instability of the alliance systems. I don't remember what the source was that I got this out of, but it was a whole page, and it was who declared war on who declared war on who, and it just filled the whole page, one country after another, because they all had various issues with their competitors.
Yeah, we talk about this in Carlisle a lot. I mean, our students read Thucydides, and one of the takeaways from Thucydides is that for all the problems between Athens and Sparta, they go to war because two of their minor allies go to war. And so we bring this up, of course, during the First World War as well, that alliances can bring you strength, but alliances leave you exposed as well. And that's fresh out of the New York Times this morning.
Mm-hmm. You know, and in this regard, too, and one of the things that we always have to keep in mind, that there are longer trend lines here, drivers, if you will, that are, it's technology, it's, again, different, the economic powers, you know, changing around, that colitis. But at the same time, there are also leaders who make choices. And I think when we get caught up in the larger trend lines, we forget that people do have a range of choice. Sometimes they might not be good choices, but history is very contingent. And so what you want to do is, let's hope that we have leaders who are able to look at trend lines but not think that things are inevitable, that they lead in some way to a crash, that there's something automatic about it. There were so many things that could have been changed that you can imagine averting this great war.
Sir?
Your comment, Dr. Wood, about commons was fascinating. And I wanted to ask the panel, particularly yourself, how you saw information conduits and information systems as a current conduit, or you see it as a current conduit that must be controlled as sea and land, as you mentioned.
Well, again, what I would say is when you think about any commons, all too often people think that it's an absolute control of something, and you don't absolutely control things. They're contested, and that you might only have partial control of something, and what you want to do is control it well enough to be able to carry out the operations that you want to carry out. You can't control all the seas, but you want to be able to move an expeditionary army over, move grain, whatever. And again, because it's contested, you can also expect to take some losses as well, that you don't have that complete control that you would like to have. Now, extrapolate that onto other commons, aerospace or onto the information domain. Again, we have to realize that we're not going to have complete control over things, because we always like to say what? The enemy has a vote, and then we ignore that. We forget that a war is about interactions, and that we should always count on an enemy that's adaptive and smart, and is trying, of course, to defeat us. So I think one word of caution I would have for today is to think you never have absolute control, but you want to build your systems to be strong enough, robust enough, to be able to carry out whatever your objectives are, the purpose, larger purpose of the war. And of course, that might require very heavy investments before the war, so that you don't start off like we are in this war of declare and prepare. You want to be better off, better prepared from the get-go to be able to go and fight.
The interesting thing is the chart, the power chart that you had, that coal, energy. What's today's power chart? How do people measure power today in those terms?
You can still look. In fact, one of the best things to do in looking at China is to look at energy consumption, because you can have all sorts of discussions about, well, what's the relative size of the Chinese economy to ours? Have they somehow surpassed us and the rest? And so one of the best numbers to look at is energy consumption for any country. And if you go to the CIA fact book, you'll be able to find that type of data. That data tends to be better than some of the economic indicators like GDP and the rest. At this time, we forget about this, but Britain was actually an energy exporter because of its coal. And indeed, our earned currency, it was one place where Britain was competitive. After the war, they weren't as competitive. Not only do you have here, energy consumption, but energy is changing too, coal to oil, which I've written about with regard to the U.S. Navy at this time. And also you have to think about self-sufficiency, food supplies, which countries are dependent upon food. China today is becoming increasingly dependent upon outside supplies of food, U.S. being generally autarkic, water supplies, all of these things. So, there's a number of metrics that I think you want to look at in comparing, doing that type of graphic to today. So, sir, I would probably want to pick out a basket of 10 or 12 things that I would want to look at. Yeah, and demographics, of course, age cohorts, education of population, numbers of computers, devices, all sorts of things.
I had a question about choices.
And the question is whether or not having plans and offensive strategies and actions actually take away from the decision to make choices, but rather follow into a quick pattern of offensive operations, which may not be appropriate for a particular time.
I more than 20 years ago now, I hate to think I'm as old as I am, but because I certainly feel younger than I am. But over 20 years ago, I wrote a book that looked at Austrian and German war planning. And the idea is that there was this cult of the offensive and that there wasn't much flexibility. And what you do when you look at Austria-Hungary and Germany's case, there was flexibility. The railway men of the general staffs, they could redeploy forces if they wanted to. So there was nothing inevitable about doing the big deployment plan west and then hitting, going after France. Germany could have reverted to the plan that the elder Moltke had, which was basically an equal division of forces between the Russian and the French fronts. And I have no doubt if they had done that, Britain would not have entered the war. the liberal government in Britain at that time would not have come into the war. They would have stood on the sidelines and been a neutral initially. So I think there was some more flexibility on the part of the Germans in 1914.
One last question, sir.
What were the innovations of the Maurer and the relative impacts?
You mean military innovations or?
Military first and industrial. Industrial played into the military, but back to the original question, what were the major innovations of the war writ large, and what were their impacts?
I think I would start with social and political innovations before I would military ones. Mm-hmm. That is, especially in Central and Eastern Europe, the four great empires, the Ottoman, Russian, German, and Austro-Hungarian, go away. And we underestimate just how incredibly shocking that was to Europe. So you have to come up with new political, social, and cultural and economic innovations. You have to come up with entire new systems. And that in my mind is the real struggle of interwar Europe, the Second World War, and as I argued this morning, I mean even down through to the Cold War, because Bolshevism is itself a product of the First World War. So to my mind, the political, social, cultural innovations are far more important than the... So I guess I'm thinking important in terms of the significance in history, not good or bad, but fascism and Bolshevism come out of this attempt to fill that space that those four empires once held.
Thank you all for coming. I think all our panelists will thank AUSA and the Center for Military and Diplomatic History for hosting this.